pop idols, actresses, the homeless, and the dreamers. There have been movies over the years which have focused on such individuals, yet few artists have dared to take such unusual and daring approaches into the likes of these people, other than a Japanese animator known as Satoshi Kon. In so doing, he stretched the limits of the medium, providing audiences with four memorable movies which have earned massive amounts of acclaim worldwide. Tonight, we are here to experience a special panel about these works and the creative genius behind them. Satoshi Kon, Master of the Mind's Eye.
Hello everyone, and welcome. My name is John Turner. One of the biggest reasons viewers like me are drawn to anime is because of how differently animation is treated in the land of the rising sun. Here in America, we usually see this art form as children's fare. The Japanese, on the other hand, see animation as another way of telling a story. As any fan of anime can tell you, it's been numerous talented directors who have made it possible. Some of these directors have been favorites: Hayao Miyazaki, Isao Takahata, Hideaki Anno, Yoshiaki Kawajiri, Mamoru Hosoda, Makoto Shinkai, Masaaki Yuasa, the list goes on and on. Satoshi Kon is among those directors. He often ranks highly on many anime fans' list of top directors, and understandably so. His work has a style that is different from his peers. As mentioned, too, his choice of subjects for animated films is unlike many that viewers have seen, especially in how he chooses to present them. But first, who is Satoshi Kon? He was born on October 12, 1963. His desire to become an animator dates back to his love of manga in high school. But it wasn't until 1991 when Mr. Kon would realize that ambition, when he worked as both an animator and background designer for the sci-fi comedy thriller Rugen Zine. He also worked on other projects, notably Mamoru Oshii's Pet Labor 2, the movie, as well as a short film called Magnetic Rose, which was part of a compilation movie called Memories. Soon after, Mr. Kon would rise to the rank of director, and in so doing, introduced a different method of telling a story. His works tend to blend fantasy and reality in ways that few other directors have done. Each of his films follow a specific formula. He begins his movies with a scene that may not have any relevance, but then pulls back the curtain and introduces us to the real plot. Throughout, he takes viewers on a wild ride of psychological depth, challenging viewers to see the situation from his lead character's point of view. Watching his movies is like searching for the pieces of a complicated puzzle. It's a true journey of the mind's eye. His first feature, Perfect Blue, is an apt example of this animator's genius. The first image we see when the movie begins is this.
Power Tron! Special Attack!
Curses! I'll get you next time, Power Tron!
This opening gives us the impression that we're going to be watching something straight out of Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. But then, the camera cuts away, and we see that this is an outdoor performance. From here, we are introduced to the real story. Fan-favorite J-pop trio Cham are putting on their latest concert to a crowd of adoring fans. One of its members, Mima Kitagoe, announces that she will be taking on a new challenge, acting.
Excuse me, who are you?
Unfortunately, her choice comes with a price, for in order to make it big, she has to do some scenes which even her agents find repulsive to watch. This takes a toll on Mima, to the point where she starts to find herself haunted and tormented by what appears to be a ghostly apparition of her former self. Matters become even nastier when some of the people responsible for getting Mima involved in her new job are mysteriously bumped off.
At some points, it is implied that Mima herself is the killer. Or is she?
Perfect Blue is an uncompromisingly dark picture. The sort of animated feature you will never see from Disney. Satoshi Kon uses all sorts of techniques to persuade the viewer to experience Mima's plight.
For instance, at the beginning of the movie, just after Cham comes on stage to sing their biggest hit, the film cuts randomly from Mima returning home to her apartment in Tokyo to her agents discussing her career, Mima's final performance, her goodbyes to her fans, and even a stop in the grocery store. All of this is meant to set viewers up for not only the events to come, but the manner in how Kon chooses to show them. As the film progresses, the scene shifts rapidly between moments where it seems as though Mima is in serious danger, and at others, when she seems to be waking up from a nightmare. In so doing, Mr. Kon asks the viewers to decide for themselves whether the incidents Mima is experiencing are real or not.
What was yesterday? Was all that real?
Perfect Blue also has its share of memorably harrowing moments. One of them happens just after Mima returns home from shooting a particularly horrific scene involving stripping before a lusty crowd. Shortly after coming into her apartment, she notices that her pet fish are dead. At this point, the emotional distress Mima has been holding back finally explodes as she trashes her apartment in a heartbreaking and horrifying meltdown.
Of course I don't want to do it, but I didn't want to tell them that all those people have done so much for me.
See, didn't I tell you? Is that really the job that you wanted? It's a pin.
Further adding to the psychological turmoil of Mima is her discovery of a fan-made website called Mima's Room, which details everything she does, including her own thoughts. Or are they?
Everyone is forcing me to do it. It's all the screenwriter's fault.
What? This isn't true! I didn't write this!
Of course you didn't. The real Mima is writing this.
Then there are the scenes where Mima is confronted with her former self.
Nobody cares for you anymore. You're tarnished and you're filthy!
Stop it! Stop it! I am not tarnished! Wait! No! Wait!
Aside from being a profile of a woman who loses her innocence, Perfect Blue takes an unpleasant look at the seedy side of the entertainment industry and the impacts it can leave on people who experience it.
Aside from the aforementioned assault scene, there is also a visit to a photographer who takes suggestive pictures of Mima. This, too, scars her.
You look beautiful. Come on, baby, be more daring. That's it.
Perfect Blue also delivers a cautionary message to fans of pop culture about the dangers of getting too obsessed with an artist's career choices.
This character, who calls himself Mamania, is one such person who goes too far. He follows Mima everywhere she goes and constantly visits Mima's room. He believes that Mima herself is the one who created the website and that the woman who has changed careers is an imposter. And he'll do anything to protect his idol.
You didn't know I was Mamania! You're just pretending to be Mimadin! Oh.
But how can it be that you...
The real Mimadin is nice. She emails me every day. And she says you're in her way.
As Mima continues to endure these hardships and complete her role in the project she is working on, the boundaries between reality and fantasy are dissolved.
Dissociative identity disorder.
In other words, multiple personality syndrome. Everything happened as a part of her own drama series. By doing this, she salvaged her own heart.
That's right, I'm an actress.
As you can tell, this is a very provocative story. It was actually based on a book written by Japanese author Yoshikazu Takeuchi. It's available in English thanks to the folks at Seven Scenes Entertainment. Although the book contains the same characters, the tale is structured rather differently, and yet, it's no less disturbing. Believe it or not, Perfect Blue was originally supposed to be a live-action direct-to-video series, but the production studio was damaged on account of the Kobe earthquake of 1995. So instead, it was decided to produce it as an animated feature. The movie received a huge backing from one of Japan's most inspirational artists, Katsuhiro Otomo, the creator of Akira. It was because of his support and influence that Perfect Blue would go on to receive great recognition. It premiered on August 5th, 1997 at Canada's Fantasia Film Festival in Montreal, earning both positive reviews and numerous awards. As a result of this success, Mr. Kon's career as a filmmaker would take flight. Released in Japan on February 28, 1998, Perfect Blue would be brought to America the next year. Here, it was released by Manga Entertainment, providing the film with a solid English dub from Anime Studios. This same English version would later be reissued by New York-based company G-Kids, who currently offers the film on Blu-ray and DVD. There have been notable adult animated features over the years, such as Fritz the Cat, Akira, Ghost in the Shell, and Ninja Scroll. Perfect Blue is arguably among the more successful entries in this category, for its willingness to tell a story few animators would dare tackling. Even better, it presents its subject for the true horror that it is, without resorting to shock value for the sake of it. There are many reasons why this film still has a loyal following today, but Perfect Blue's subject matter may be too much for squeamish viewers. Fortunately, Satoshi Kon's next feature, Millennium Actress, is a far more accessible choice for anyone curious to check out this man's work. It's the opposite of Perfect Blue, but no less impactful. As with his first movie, Mr. Kon chooses to open Millennium Actress in a manner that gives us a deceiving impression to what his story will be. We find ourselves in outer space, and the camera slowly draws us to a space station located on the moon. Then, we see a rocket with a young woman seated in the capsule, preparing to blast off. The countdown begins.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
But then we pull back and realize that this scene is actually a movie being watched by television interviewer Genya Tachibana. At this point, Millennium Actress's real plot takes flight. Tachibana and his cameraman, Kyoji Ida, pay a visit to retired actress Chiyoko Fujiwara. A former star of the once prestigious Genei Studios, Miss Fujiwara has lived in recluse for 30 years. Even so, she is very pleased to be interviewed, especially when Genya gives her a precious memento.
The key to open the most important thing. I never thought that I would hold it again in my hand.
Well, I suppose we should get started then, yes?
Over the course of the rest of the film, we follow Chiyoko as she reflects on both her career and life. Interestingly, both Genya and Kyoji are seen as participants in these flashbacks.
Aren't we here to be making a documentary about her life or something?
Yes, of course we are. Here we go! Seven Transformations! The Legend of Chiyoko Fujiwara!
Wow. I swear, old people are so weird.
Genya, in particular, gets to play various characters in these flashbacks from time to time. In fact,
It seems like he might have a personal connection with Chiyoko.
I will never forget that you have done this for me today.
Oh, from the day you arrived, I have wanted to help you somehow. In any way that I could be of service.
Would you please pull yourself together?
Cameraman Kyonji supplies comic relief throughout.
This role suits you! Way to go, boss!
We also meet a variety of different characters, including a flirtatious film director, a jealous co-star, as well as a mysterious and creepy old woman. Most important is a fugitive artist on the run from a shady man with a scar on his face. Chiyoko rescues and heals the fugitive, leading to a tender scene which also reveals how she got the key.
Oh, this? It's the key to opening what is most important. Can you take a guess?
I don't know. But please don't tell me. It'll be my homework for tomorrow. Pinky promise?
Unfortunately, the two are separated, and Chiyoko vows to find him, no matter what it takes. From here, Millennium Actress turns into a roller coaster ride as we find ourselves shifting through numerous movies that Chiyoko worked on, including historical period pieces, war movies, Godzilla flicks, space operas, you name it. All the while, Chiyoko determines to reunite with the mysterious artist.
Every single day, I love him more dearly than the last!
The major triumph of Millennium Actress is its ability to be a docudrama, a fantasy, a mystery, a time travel piece, and even a love story, all in one. It does sound like a rather bizarre recipe for a movie, but Satoshi Kon manages to make it all work. The end result is not only a fascinating experience, but a genuine work of art as well.
Aside from being an emotionally engaging and thoughtful story, the film is rich with lavishly painted backgrounds and several breathtaking sequences. It's also one of those films that merits repeat viewings, for there are subtle details one might miss out on the first time they see this movie.
Unlike Perfect Blue, this movie is not based on any existing book. Millennium Actress's plot was penned by Mr. Kon himself. Some of the events in this tale also stem from experiences in Kon's life. For instance, after the release of Perfect Blue, its distribution company, Rex Entertainment, went bankrupt. It's perhaps because of this that Kon chooses to open Millennium Actress with Ganei Studios being demolished. For the rest of the film, Mr. Kon relied on both his memories and imagination, aspiring for its plot to be a mixture of both. It was his idea to have Millennium Actress and Perfect Blue be two different perspectives of the same concept, a sort of pair of sister films, if you will. But while Perfect Blue deals with its subject in heavy matters, Millennium Actress chooses to be more positive about it, especially how it treats its protagonist. Another thing that Perfect Blue and Millennium Actress share in common is that both films debuted in Montreal, Canada. The critics and public would first experience Mr. Kon's second film at the 2001 Fantasia Film Festival on July 28th to enthusiastic response. Millennium Actress would go on to be released in Japanese theaters on September 14th, 2002. When it comes to the American release, however, here's where matters get complicated. The film was picked up for distribution by DreamWorks Studios' art house company, Go Fish Pictures, who released the film in Japanese with English subtitles, both theatrically and on DVD. Oddly, however, Millennium Actress did receive a dubbed version from the folks at Manga in the United Kingdom in 2005. Here's what it sounds like.
Do you really have to leave? Now?
I said that I'd go to him.
We all say a lot of things, but you can't...
I promised him. I hoped you'd understand.
Wait. Stop! You can't leave like this! Come back!
I'm begging you to stay.
Six, five, four,
3, 2, 1, 0.
I never thought I would hold this in my hands again. Shall we begin the interview, Mr. Takibana?
Could I see?
It's nothing. Just a sketch. It's to help me remember so I can finish the painting when I get home.
This is Chiyoko. She'll be playing the lead in this movie.
How do you do?
I don't need to ask if you recognize Shimao Eiko. Not just our own, but the country's biggest star.
What nonsense. Nice to meet you, Chike.
It would seem this man left you a little memento on your storeroom wall.
He did that? I mean, what?
So you do know him.
I can't remember.
You cannot escape your fate. You will burn forever in the flames of eternal love.
This version never saw an American release. It wasn't until 2019 that Millennium Actress would be picked up for a brief reissue and an all-new English version, thanks to the folks at 11 Arts Studios. Based in Los Angeles, the company has issued modern favorites such as A Silent Voice, Machia, and Penguin Highway. Here's how their dub sounds like.
Do you really have to go?
I made a promise. No matter what, that I would go to him.
Don't go! Please don't!
You are my one true...
May I see it?
It's just a sketch. I plan to finish it as soon as I get home.
This is Chiyoko Fujiwara, who'll play the lead character.
How do you do?
I am sure that you will recognize our biggest star, Miss Eiko Shimao.
Hello, Chieko Fujiwara.
He left you a nice little something back in the storeroom of your home, a memento.
He left something? For me?
So you do know him.
I can't remember. Not even his face.
You shall burn in the flames of eternal love!
After a brief theatrical showing, the new dub of Millennium Actress would premiere on Blu-ray and DVD on December 10th, 2019, along with a host of extras. However you choose to watch it, Millennium Actress is a beautiful film. Lively, funny at times, touching, and poignant, with an ending that will surely move you to tears. All it takes is just one view to fall under its spell. Within 2 years, Satoshi Kon would release his third feature, Tokyo Godfathers. It's quite a change of pace from his previous films, and arguably one of his most accessible. If the title sounds intimidating, worry not. This film is nothing at all like The Godfather, no crime lord family stories here. This is a much lighter, but touching film, and it happens to set during Christmas, one of the few anime features to do so. In fact, it's loosely based on the book, The Three Godfathers. Once more, Mr. Kon begins his third feature with a scene which may seem to be unrelated to what is about to unfold, but turns out to be much more symbolic. Shortly after, we meet our protagonists. Gin, a middle-aged man. Hana, a transgender woman. And Miyuki, a teenage girl. All three are outcasts in Tokyo, living on the streets. One Christmas Eve, the trio are rummaging through garbage when they find an abandoned baby girl. Hana adopts the child and names her Kyoko, which means pure child. Incidentally, that's what Silent Night is translated as in Japanese, which explains the nativity performance we saw previously.
This bundle of joy is a Christmas present sent from God! She's our baby now!
Huh?
We follow these misfits as they try to reunite the baby with her parents. It is yet another mystery story from Mr. Kon, as the three of them only receive small pieces of the puzzle behind their charge's origins. Gradually, these pieces fall into place as the film progresses. Their quest doubles as something of a tour guide around Tokyo, a tone further emphasized by the painstakingly detailed backgrounds and panoramic shots as the camera glides through the cityscape.
Usually, we think of Japan's largest city as a busy metropolis with skyscrapers, crowds, and businesses everywhere. But this film shows us a side of Tokyo we don't normally see.
Mr. Kon takes us to the back alleys and rundown tenements, as well as both swanky and seedy clubs. There, we are introduced to different types of displaced communities. Runaways, transgenders, vagrants, and immigrants, all living in circumstances beyond their control and struggling to survive. This provides for a rather different sort of mind's eye experience than Satoshi Kon's previous two movies. It almost seems as though Tokyo itself is a character too.
Aside from being a quest story, mystery, and social commentary on the neglected, Tokyo Godfathers is also a surprisingly funny film, with much of the humor coming from the exchanges between this makshift family.
No, okay, you don't have to.
I know. That's not your real mommy. That's just a homeless homo.
You don't say things like that to a baby.
You know what sounds a lot weirder? The fact we have a crying baby in here.
We're gonna take you to the police real soon, okay?
And don't worry, your thing right here.
She is not. We're taking her to the police. That's final.
She'll never shut up if you don't stop shouting.
Each of the three main characters is as richly complex as they are compelling, with backstories that will tug the heartstrings of even the iciest of viewers. Gin initially comes across as an alcoholic and claims that he tragically lost his wife and daughter, but he hides a lot about his past. Despite his gruff demeanor, however, he always comes through for those he cares about when the occasion demands.
Gin, you're amazing! You're not an action star, you're a superstar!
Hana, who once worked at the Angel Tower Club, is revealed to have lost her lover in a tragic accident, and it scars her emotionally. In spite of that, however, she has a warm, caring, and rather exuberant personality. It is her wish to be a mother which compels her to adopt the child. She can be a bit theatrical at times, but that only adds to her appeal.
I don't want her to go from one foster home to another without ever feeling truly loved.
It's Miyuki who carries the hugest burden of all. She ran away from home after a fight with her father. Racked with guilt over the incident, Miyuki often tries to hide it. Yet she is much more vulnerable than she comes across. Miyuki also has an affinity for cats, to the point where she is very, very protective of them.
Have you ever wondered if cat meat's any good?
Try anything and I'll end you!
Just a joke.
Calm down.
In spite of its more straightforward approach in terms of how it chooses to present its story, Tokyo Godfathers does, on occasion, make some quirky choices in its style. The opening credits, for instance, are displayed in a rather creative manner, as you see here. There is even a hidden Easter egg during this scene.
And what kind of parent abandons their newborn alone in the freezing cold? Those aren't parents at all. Those are devils.
And for the ending credits, we see the cityscape of Tokyo rock out. Yes, rock out! To a familiar tune. For all its bits of humor, however, Tokyo Godfathers isn't afraid to showcase grittier moments. At one point, a gang of teenage hoodlums attack both Gin and an old man brutally. At another, we learn that Miyuki stabbed her father during their argument.
Both of these acts of violence are based on real-life incidents which happened in Japan around the time the film was made. Including scenes like this provide the film with a gritty, harrowing edge, a stark reminder of the times we live in.
Yet there are plenty of lighter scenes to keep audiences enthralled. Particularly entertaining is a fast-paced finale involving a chase between cars and trucks, collisions, races through buildings, and dangerous stunts.
Get this Hanga-chan past her!
I can't, we'll die!
Step on it!
Okay!
All of this makes Tokyo Godfathers the most unconventional of Satoshi Kon's movies. That is to say, it's more realistically grounded than the likes of Perfect Blue and Millennium Actress, in that it doesn't involve as much fantasy or mind-bending. Simultaneously, however, it's also one of his most appealing.
The film premiered at New York's Big Apple Anime Fest on August 30th, 2003, to a glorious response. Crowds of eager fans packed the theater and enthusiastically welcomed Satoshi Kon as the director himself greeted the audience.
In November, the film made its debut in Japan, where it received a similar warm reception. Sony Pictures Classics provided Tokyo Godfathers with a limited theatrical release in America on December 29, 2003, in Japanese with English subtitles. Sony hoped that this would earn Satoshi Kon's latest film an Academy Award for Best Animated Feature, but sadly, it never happened. For years after its release on DVD, fans would only be able to watch this film with its native language track. As with Millennium Actress, two English versions exist for Tokyo Godfathers. The first dub was made exclusively for cable television network Animax Asia. Only those who have access to Animax Asia were able to see this version, as it never received any kind of release on DVD. Here's how this rare version sounds like.
Hey, wait!
I know, sweetheart. It's hard. You want your mommy, right? Not some homeless hobo.
Don't say things like that! Not in front of her!
People are gonna freak out when they hear a baby crying around here, you know.
Don't worry, girl. We're gonna take you to the police soon.
You don't want to go anywhere, do you, Kyoko?
Yes, she does! And we're taking her to the police, fool!
Quit yelling or she'll never shut up!
17 years after its first premiere, however, Tokyo Godfathers would finally receive a proper English version, courtesy of the folks at NYAV Post. The cast features a host of experienced vocal performers, headed by real-life trans actress Shakina Nafak.
The only thing you've ever accomplished in life is stinking up the room! So do us all a favor and throw yourself away, you worthless pile of trash!
I think the message of Tokyo Godfathers is that the people that in our society we so often look down upon or disregard or don't even see are worthy of our love, are worthy of respect, and are capable of goodness and greatness. I think if we can continue to see people through the eyes that Satoshi Kon wanted us to see them, that we're carrying on his legacy, and that's important.
This new translation of Tokyo Godfathers was commissioned by G-Kids, who remastered the film and gave it a brief theatrical re-release before issuing it to Blu-ray and DVD. There have been relatively few anime films that have set around Christmas. Tokyo Godfathers fills this niche in its own charming, quirky, heartfelt way. It also triumphantly succeeds in all of its ambition to provide its own perspective, one that will no doubt challenge one's preconceived notions of what it's like to be in Tokyo, especially if you're an outcast. Satoshi Kon's fourth feature was one that he had wanted to make since completing his first. But Paprika, based on a novel written in 1993 by Yasutaka Tsutsui, took a considerable amount of time to make, partially on account of difficulties finding a distributor. Enter Sony Pictures Studios. Fans had to wait 3 years after Mr. Kon's previous film to experience Paprika, but the wait was worth it, It's a sumptuously dazzling and wild ride of a film. Truly one of a kind.
As always, Mr. Kon begins the film with a scene which seems irrelevant to the rest of the story he's about to tell, at least initially.
And now, boys and girls, it's showtime!
What better way to open a film than A Night at the Circus? But as this rousing scene unfolds, the camera draws us into the audience, where we meet Detective Konakawa, one of the main protagonists of this story. And from here, the scene turns strange in every way imaginable.
One, two, three!
Great! Give me another one!
Luckily, it turns out to be a dream. And herein lies the focus for Paprika's storyline. It's kind of complicated to explain, but here's the gist of it. Set in a futuristic time, the plot centers on a peculiar creation.
This little device is called the DC Mini. It's the scientific key that allows us to open the door to our dreams.
Then captures them on a computer? It's a perfect dream machine.
Indeed. And the supervisor of the project is a chirpy woman known as Paprika. Actually, she's the alter ego of the straight-faced, down-to-earth Dr. Otsuko Chiba. She's part of the research team developing the DC Mini as a therapeutic tool. But in this early stage of development, using it outside the team with people like Konakawa is strictly unauthorized. The plot kicks into gear when the DC Mini is stolen. At this point, Paprika turns into both a mystery and thriller as our heroine, Konakawa, and two other loyal scientists, Chief Shima and Dr. Tokita, search for the thief. Over the course of their journey, the metaphysical barrier between reality and fiction literally bursts as characters jump between dreams and dreams threaten to become a true nightmare.
Still with me? Paprika is arguably the most psychedelic of Satoshi Kon's films. As mentioned, it's a kaleidoscopic journey through a series of sequences ranging from the haunting to the bizarre. In fact, some anime fans have called this feature the equivalent of Christopher Nolan's Inception. I wouldn't be surprised if Mr. Nolan's Thriller was inspired by this movie.
The beautifully rendered animation makes Paprika a visual treat. Furthermore, the artistic choice of rapidly shifting between different scenes for the various dreams are a perfect fit for the subject. Having said that, Paprika still has its share of disturbing moments which may not make it ideal for sensitive viewers, although nowhere near the extreme of perfect blue. Most of these moments are creepy more than anything else, but the film nonetheless earns its R rating.
There have been certain movies where the primary attraction is breathtaking visuals and not much substance, but Paprika, for all its flashy style, still offers some surprisingly complex subjects. This movie's journey of the mind's eye is, of course, from dreamers.
The various images that we see during these dreams provide an insightful examination of humanity's deepest thoughts. It's as much of a psychological journey as it is a trippy one, no pun intended. This is further emphasized by its characters expressing emotions like envy, ambition, lust, guilt, and naturally, greed. Science plays a crucial role in Paprika's storyline, particularly in the case of Dr. Tukita, the overweight child in a genius's body. He believes strongly in the use of the DC Mini for beneficial purposes.
The ability to see a friend's dream as if it were your own inspirational experience. Both of you sharing the same dream.
You're able to treat people's illnesses by looking at their dreams?
Yeah, that's exactly it!
Despite Dr. Tokita's noble intentions, however, when his unprotected dream project falls into the wrong hands, the results are catastrophic, as well as deadly. It causes people to be brainwashed into crazed stupors, marching deliriously toward an impending death. Even a level-headed man like Chief Shima can be driven to do the unthinkable as a result of this disaster.
No one gets in the way of my glory train! They need to really analyze all the livers of the Triangle Goose Party! Ah! This whole festival was put together by 23rd graders with lots of chutzpah and one panda! You see? Now I am truly grand! The ultimate one!
Ha 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 ha! Chief!
Shine!
Shine! Take me! Take me now!
This exchange between Chiba and Tokita pretty much says it all for the film's message.
What I need to do right now is finish the project I'm working on.
You are so selfishly wrapped up in what you want to do that you ignore what needs to be done. You never coded the DC Mini. That was just irresponsible. It cost lives, don't you get it?
Of course not. Not much gets through all that protective fat, now does it? Here's what does. What a scientist. He's so amazing. It's like a really bad joke. What good is a scientist to mankind if he doesn't care about people,
At other moments in Paprika, various characters liken these dreams to movies, a point driven further when the camera occasionally cuts to the inside of a movie theater.
Any REM sleep that occurs later in the sleep cycle is a bit longer and much easier to analyze. If we were to compare dreams to films, the earlier cycles would be artsy film shorts. A later cycle would be a full-length feature.
The internet plays a small role in this story, serving as something of a gateway between the dream world and the human world, as this scene demonstrates.
Hello again.
What is this place?
A counseling room, a meeting place, a dating spot, take your pick. I bet you never thought about it, but the internet and dreams are similar. They're areas where the repressed conscious mind escapes.
I have prepared your drinks, ma'am.
Over the course of its 90-minute running time, Paprika unfolds at a riveting pace, moving from one location to the next, throwing audiences into one crazy moment after another. The conflict builds to a chaotic climax where the dream world and the real world mesh in the most disastrous and apocalyptic way imaginable.
What is that thing, Shima?
It's our chairman!
I am reborn to make my universe complete. I shall heal the deficiencies your neglect has caused and purify the earth by destroying whatever I please.
The film also has its share of occasional inside jokes. For instance, two minor characters in the story, a pair of bartenders called Janai and Kuga, are both modeled after Satoshi Kon and author Yasutaka Tsutsui, respectively. I'm going to show you guys a picture of what Mr. Kon and Mr. Tsutsui look like. And here's how they look in Paprika. Notice the similarities?
To top it all off, the final scene also includes this Easter egg.
Paprika debuted at the 63rd Venice Film Festival on September 2nd, 2006, receiving praise from critics and viewers. It has shown up in several lists among the top animated films of all time. Even big-name talent, such as Lord of the Rings star Elijah Wood, have raved about this movie. Paprika is currently available on DVD and Blu-ray from Sony Pictures, with both the Japanese version and a solid English dub. However you choose to watch this movie, Paprika is a spectacularly thrilling experience seldom found in animated features, and as mentioned, merits multiple viewings to untangle the web of its multifaceted story. Before long, Satoshi Kon would begin work on a fifth feature, Dreaming Machine. Unfortunately, this master animator would not live to realize his latest vision. He died of pancreatic cancer on August 24th, 2010. He was 46. As of today, Dreaming Machine remains unfinished, and it's unlikely that anyone will pluck up the courage to pick up where its creator left off. All four of Satoshi Kon's movies were animated at Madhouse Studios, one of Japan's most prolific animation facilities. Founded in 1972 by a quartet of animators, the company has produced more than 200 works for video, television, and film.
Their most notable works include Ninja Scroll, Vampire Hunter D Bloodlust, Record of Lotus War OVA, Trigun, and modern favorites like The Girl Who Leapt Through Time, as well as Wolf Children. Satoshi Kon's four films are lauded for their aesthetic as they are for their stories, and the lavish skill of Madhouse's artistry complements them beautifully. In addition to these four feature films, Satoshi Kon has also produced one short, Ohio, which means good morning, as well as one television series, Paranoia Ancient. Both contain the same style and hallmarks of his other works.
There has never been another animator quite like Satoshi Kon, and it is tragic that his career was cut short. However, the appeal of his work has not died with him, quite the opposite. To this day, there are legions of both animation fans and critics who have cited this man as a true genius of the genre, and rightly so. No matter where he chose to take his audiences, his movies were clever amalgams of mystery, emotion, and above all, perspectives. He was a visionary, a storyteller, a true master of the mind's eye. That his work continues to receive accolades is another testament to his talent. Which brings us to the end of our showcase of Satoshi Kon. I hope you found it enjoyable and interesting, and that I've expanded your insights. If you haven't seen any of Mr. Kon's films, I hope I've encouraged you to check them out. You'll never feel the same way again. I have other panels planned, and they'll premiere right here on Virtual Panel Theater. Also, when cons start again, I hope to present them in person to you. But until then, this is John Turner saying, stay safe, everybody. Thanks for coming, and I'll see you next time. Goodbye for now.